call, please.
Mr. McGill?
Here.
Mr. Russo?
Here.
And Mr. Zellman is absent.
Correct. Okay, brings us to approval of the minutes of April 10th, 2018.
I move that we approve the minutes of April 2018.
I will second that motion. Roll call, please.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
And Mr. Russo?
Yes. Okay, brings us to report. Item number one is the jail report. Chief, anything you need to bring to the committee's attention?
Nothing, Mr. Chairman, other than just to point out that our average daily population numbers are hovering around 20, and when I took over in 2011, we were barely breaking 11 at times, so we're doing a relatively good job of keeping a full stable so that we can guarantee mm-hmm. revenue for the city. So,
great. Thank you. Any questions?
No, sir.
Okay. Great. Okay. Let's see. Chief Shaw.
I saw his car go by.
All right. Well, we'll come back to item number two.
Here.
Here he comes.
Oh, there he is. Okay. Chief, you're just in time for your item here. Okay. Item number two is an online form submittal. And again, typically, there's not a lot of credence in online submittals where there's no name, a phony email address, or a phony phone number. But I think the issue that was raised, I think, warranted just an explanation. And also, there was some concern of what process the fire department follows in putting out the warning. This concerned the tornado warning that went off in Schwinsburg, but not in Solon. So, Chief.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. We did get what I call a ghost. It was an email correspondence with a fake email address, so we aren't able to return any response to those. But we did want to take the opportunity to educate the public a little bit on this issue. Mm-hmm. The sirens, of course, were installed back in 2001, 2002. Significant upgrades were made. We have over a dozen units that cover the community. But the one important point I do want to make is that the sirens it's an outdoor warning siren system. It's always been called that. It's always been intended for that. It's to warn people who are outdoors away from mass media and possibly some of their personal electronics. So as we have a graphic here, I don't know if they're, okay, they are showing it, from the National Weather Service. Sirens are for outdoor warning purposes and are not meant to be heard indoors. That was never the intended purpose of these devices. However, some people do reap that benefit because of their proximity of their home to the siren. Hearing the siren is a signal to get indoors and seek additional information. We've always tried to educate the public to do exactly that. Go to your favorite media outlet, whatever TV station it may be, and usually there's a breaking news or a breaking weather event or something of those nature. On the particular day in question, tornado warnings were issued for Summit and I believe Portage County. It did not include Cuyahoga County, nor did it include Solon. The procedure in the fire department is when a foul weather is in the area in an adjacent county that the shift officer is to monitor the weather using the same media outlets that anybody else would. We find that those TV stations are pretty good. They're all trying to one-up each other on exactly where the path is going to go, even naming particular communities. Solon was never named in any of the tornado warnings, so quite frankly there was no need to cause unnecessary alarm. The only wind damage that we had here in Solon were some limbs that were down. And the only storm-related call that we went on in that period was, in fact, to Twinsburg for wires down because they were inundated with calls. You know, the bottom line is there was really no need to sound the sirens that evening. We tried to strike a very delicate balance between overwarning the public and scaring people and warning them when there actually is a threat. We don't want people to ignore them because, geez, here they go again, they're overreacting, mm-hmm. That type of thing. And that is a tough balance to achieve. We think we've been able to achieve that balance over the years, though.
All right. Any questions? Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Chief.
Thanks, Chief.
Okay, we have nothing under referrals or police and fire. Brings us to traffic enforcement. Item number three, April traffic report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You have the monthly report in front of you. Nothing significant to mention other than the fact that we did address a complaint from council about truck traffic on Cannon Road with selective enforcement and citations. and we're currently working through another council request from Mr. Palunas about traffic on Ida Drive. Speed trailer is now up and running for the summer, so we'll be deploying it at various different places, and the first place we did deploy it was Ada Drive.
Great, thank you. Any questions?
No. Okay. Thanks, Chief.
Okay, brings us to engineering. Item number four is the fencing at the Solon Community Park Tennis Courts. Mr. Holub?
Yes, thank you. As you know, last year, at the end of the year, we started the project of totally renovating the Solon Community Park Tennis Courts. There's a total of 12 courts, and it was to be done in two phases. The first phase was obviously doing six courts, tearing down all the fence. There were the poles for the fencing, there was a limit of about 10 poles that they were going to tear down for the whole project. After looking at the poles, the contractor said it would probably be easier just to take down all the poles and replace all of them, and they did that at no charge. One of the problems, however, is as we went back and looked at the existing fence that was going to be put back up on those poles, we felt that it, first of all, the new poles are going to be black. The old fence was painted green. And that fence was put on when the courts came into being about 25 years ago. Be quite honest with you, it would look almost ridiculous if we put that fence back on after looking at the fence on the brand new poles and with the brand new courts. We just feel that this is well worth the price and will look 100% better if we were to change to the new fencing. And so that, actually John Bush had talked to the contractor and they gave you a price, which is in your memo, of $40,250. And that's for all the fence, not just the six that are currently being redone. That's for all 12 courts. I should point out too that the schools are participating in this project also at one-third the cost.
Thank you. Any questions?
No, I'm good.
Okay, is there a motion?
I would request legislation be prepared authorizing a change order to contract number 2016.29 in the amount of $40,250 for new fencing for all of the tennis courts in Solon Community Park, and this be placed under emergency.
Okay, I will second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
And Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Item number five, the RTA bus stop at Harper and Aurora. We don't have any, there's no new material in that?
No.
Okay. Keep that on. Item number six, Preserve Subdivision Homeowners Association License Agreement. Anything new on that?
No new material this month.
Okay. All right, brings us to item number seven, Community Center Indoor Pool HVAC Replacement, final closeout. Carrie?
This is for the final closeout of the HVAC unit that was at the Community Center. The contract amount was $551,000. There were no change orders, and the completion of the project was done before the end of the completion date. This is just the customary paperwork for the final closeout.
Okay. Any questions? Okay. Is there a motion?
I would request legislation be prepared authorizing closeout of contract 2017.16, final amount of $551,000.
Okay, I will second that. Any further discussion?
No, sir.
Hearing none, roll call, please.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Item number eight is the traffic engineer service contract with GPD. Carrie?
This item, while we were processing the documents, the contract documents for GPD, Mike had brought to my attention that the rate sheet for the contract was incorrect. When they put together the proposal, he had stapled the wrong rate sheet. So this was to correct the rate sheet for the duration of the project, which would be the 2018 to 2020.
Any questions?
No.
Okay. Yeah, because it looked like it was just change in personnel or some differences in personnel. Rates stayed the same?
Yes, the new personnel. The rates are actually, there was a proposed fee schedule in the packet, and the rates matched that proposed fee schedule.
Right.
The original one didn't match.
Right. Okay, great. Okay, is there a motion?
I move that we incorporate the corrected rate sheet into the contract with GPD Services for the contract from June 1st, 2018 to May 31st, 2020.
I will second. Any further discussion? Hearing none. Roll call, please.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Okay, brings us to item number 9, Chick-fil-A. I guess there's a traffic impact study done. Again, this is just only going to be from a safety perspective. First, before we go through the actual plans themselves, anything, any issues from police or fire for these plans? Okay. And who is going to present the mic?
All right, thank you, Mr. Chairman. This current site plan is shown on the document camera. Traffic impact study was submitted. Comments were made in April, and a second submittal of that traffic impact study was done here recently. Our comments are in your packet. To hit the important notes of our comments, starting out first with the site plan itself and the site plan layout. This particular site plan is new to Northeast Ohio for Chick-fil-A's. The current site plans that are out there in Warrensville Heights and in the Akron area have drive-throughs that circulate the building. This particular site plan is a new plan for Chick-fil-A, and they pull the drive-through queue off in a manner that does not impact pedestrian access to the front of the building, so that's a good safety feature. The big concern that we had with this particular use is its popularity. For whatever reason, Chick-fil-A's are enormously popular in this area, and our concern was with the drive-through stacking to make sure that we did not have a queuing issue that backed out into the parking lot area here, or even worse, out onto the street. So we asked for a very extensive queuing analysis and queuing review to be done of area adjacent Chick-fil-A's, again in Warrensville Heights and in the Fairlawn area, and they acquired video data for a period of a week so that we could evaluate the drive-through queuing at those locations and determine how that might apply here to the Solon site. And based on all of that information that was pulled together by the applicant, our conclusion is, from the best of everyone's ability, they've demonstrated that the drive-through queue that's shown here with this recent site plan change to add a bypass lane to allow either a dual food delivery system where there's a worker here that's handing food out to two drive-through lanes, or if they're passing food out here to cars in the queue, then these cars could bypass the pickup window and exit the site faster. With this recent change and the information that they've provided, to the best of their ability and the best of our ability to review, we do not believe that there will be a queuing issue here with traffic backing out onto the service road. The one request I think that's outstanding from our review letter, as we did not have this most current site plan when we reviewed the traffic study, is just a general request from the applicant to discuss or provide some contingency plan. You know, should this site be wildly popular, more so than is available around here, how would they handle trying to coordinate traffic if in the event that it did back out of the drive-through lane? I do expect, and you can put this in the record, Margie, the opening day is probably going to draw a lot of traffic, and we're probably going to have traffic issues opening day. No different than you'd see in any other type of attraction. You know, when Starbucks opened, we had lots of traffic at Starbucks, and that calmed down. So we're looking at normal operation here, not necessarily a single day event. And based on normal operation of adjacent locations, we do not believe this is going to be a problem.
Okay, great. Doug, do you have any questions?
I do. I have a bunch of questions, and I apologize because normally I have a chance to call people and ask them about it, but I've been otherwise occupied for the last few days. Quick question, on page, it says page 1, or excuse me, page 11, the left turn lane along Cruzy Drive are not warranted based upon the proposed volumes at the entrance. Can you explain that to me?
So as part of a normal traffic impact study, we asked that the applicant evaluate adjacent intersections for traffic signal warrants and turn lane warrants. So they looked at the intersection right here of Cruzy Drive and the access road to determine if a new left turn lane was required turning from Cruzy Drive onto the access road. Based upon the analysis that was done to ODOT standards, there was no left turn lane required.
And this is anecdotal. I claim nothing more than that, but at times during the day when I have gone to Cruzy Drive to observe traffic there, it is backed up from that intersection on Solon Road past that service drive. So the next question is, if looking at your diagram, and I know I'm pointing at something that you can't see, but as the drive-through lane goes around the corner and it becomes two lanes to exit, where do those cars go?
These here?
Yes.
They would exit either back across the front of the property to the access road, or they could also circulate through the adjacent parking lot through cross access agreements and come out at the access road over here on 91 as well.
Okay. So that's entirely probable that they'll be cutting through Rose's parking lot to get out.
I would assume the applicants have a cross access agreement to allow that. Is that correct?
All right. Now that tells me then, and of course, some of them will be going through the parking lot, and I think that could cause a pedestrian problem. But if they go back to the service drive, some of them may turn right onto that service drive then. is that service drive wide enough to handle that kind of traffic both ways?
It's a service drive designed to provide access to commercial property, so I would answer yes. You're not going to see a lot of truck traffic going that direction. That would be of concern, but two cars could pass on that driveway.
Okay. Now, Chief Island isn't going to like this question, but as that service drive exits onto Solon Road, people being how they are, is it entirely possible that people will try and turn left onto Solon Road from there?
I have to be honest, Mr. McGill, I don't know exactly the direction, and if you could re-describe which turn you're describing for me.
Well, the service road girdles the two properties, Rose's, and so it exits on Cruzy Drive, and then it goes around the other side. I think it was the Bell Telephone Building, Bill?
I think so.
Out onto Somme Center Road, correct?
Onto Somme Center Road. No, onto Solon Road.
Somme Center Road.
I'm sorry, Somme Center Road, correct. So people being people, is it possible that some people would try and turn left there?
At the Somme Center Road end.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, okay.
It's currently not a restricted movement, so.
I know it's not.
Yes.
But at some point in time, I heard, Bill, you'll have to correct me on this, that intersection, Somme Center and 91, is one of the two or three busiest intersections in Cuyahoga County. Is that true?
It's one of the busiest. I don't know if it's in the top two, but it is one of the busiest intersections in the county, yes.
Okay, so that would create additional problems at that intersection, would it not?
It potentially would, and the applicant's traffic study indicated that if that became an issue, they would recommend restricting this access to right in, right out only.
Which means the only entrance would be off of Cruzy Drive.
You would still need to, you still could come southbound and turn right. I don't anticipate a lot of
northbound. And go through Rose's parking lot again.
Well, you still could circulate the access road this way and come onto the site here on this side. I don't anticipate a lot of northbound traffic making that movement during the times when Chick-fil-A would have their peak demand. It will be almost impossible to make that movement anyway. And in fact, we had them perform their traffic analysis, assuming, going back here to the picture camera for a second, assuming no one would be able to make this left movement or make a right turn movement and then make a left turn movement onto Solon Road.
My question was, not that they would be allowed to or not to, but would they? Chief Island being a cynical realist, would say yes.
I prefer pragmatist, but
okay.
Thank you very much.
I'll accept your definition. Looking at the statistics for the hours, I know there's kind of a double loop pattern in terms of, you know, lunchtime and then dinner time with all of these. Now, I went up to Euclid Avenue to watch that for a while, and I went down to Macedonia to look at them for a while. I didn't spend any time in Warrensville Heights. But there were times when they had 20 or 30 cars in the evening backed up. And that's beyond what we're showing here in terms of our analysis. And I apologize, I can't put my finger on it right now. At some point it said that they reduced the potential number from 14% to 12%. That was kind of an averaging down of the statistics for a certain time of day.
Mm-hmm.
And I look at, you know, the population of Solon doubles during the day, does it not? And my guess is that this will be popular. I love the idea of having a Chick-fil-A in Solon, but I'm not sure we have correctly identified all the potential problems with traffic. I'm not sure there's a good solution. As I walked the property the other day and looked at the road, I don't know that there's any place to widen on either side. And my concern is that if we start getting backup into that service drive, then you have a real problem on Cruzy Drive.
Mm-hmm.
And people doing what people are going to do because they're going to get in a hurry, they're going to try and dump out that service drive and then we have not only a busy intersection, but a really busy intersection.
Mm-hmm.
So my concerns with Chick-fil-A are strictly related to traffic at this point in time. Now, I need to spend more time studying this and perhaps talking with the experts here, but that's my concern at this point in time.
With regard to that concern, we can only ask them to do so much. Based on the study that they've prepared, it is done to all required standards, ODOT and City of Solon standards, which went above and beyond asking them what they needed to do as far as impacting the surrounding roadways. And as far as their drive-through queue, we agreed with you, Councilman McGill, that I don't believe their analysis. That was why I asked for them to do all the videotaping that they did.
Yes.
And we determined from our own conclusions that based on the operations of adjacent sites, that they've satisfied my concern as best as they possibly could.
Okay.
Now, is it possible, and that was my comment 9 on my review letter, or comment 8 actually, is it possible that the demand at this location is going to be more than any of us could possibly imagine? Sure it is. But from an analytical perspective, there are manuals that need to be used for what's called trip generation. That's what they've used, and that's what is accepted industry-wide. They've met those parameters. The queue analysis, if you bring their engineer up and ask him if anyone has ever asked them to do anything like that ever before, I would be willing to bet that they would say no. So we've asked them to go above and beyond to try to justify, in my mind, that this isn't going to be an issue. And to the best of their ability and the best of our ability reviewing all of the information, we don't believe it's going to be a problem. Having said that, that goes back to my request of what are they going to do if it does back out? You know, they're proposing a stacking area here, I think it's for 27 vehicles. Of the video that we reviewed, there was not an instance of 27 vehicles stacking on any of the sites that we looked at. They did get to 26, so that was very close to the numbers that you're throwing out. But at the same time, those 26 vehicles, you know, were in the drive-through queue for 23 minutes. To get around from entering the queue to getting through food and leaving. So it becomes to a point, how long are you willing to sit in a queue to get your food? Is it really gonna take, if it takes 23 minutes, you're probably not gonna sit there much longer than 30 if it takes, you know, 30 cars to fill this. So from that perspective, I think it comes to a point of people's tolerance is gonna run out and they're gonna do what I do when I go to Chick-fil-A. I go park and I walk in and walk out in 10 minutes with my food instead of waiting 23 minutes in the drive-through lane. That was also one of the concerns. I would have been completely opposed to this site if they would not have added the drive-through bypass lane, because if you did get a car here stuck at the window without a bypass lane, that could definitely back the queue up and let it not empty out. So.
You done with your question?
Thanks, Chairman.
Okay, I've got a few.
Okay.
Councilman Zeldin was not able to make it tonight, and he did have questions that he asked me to ask Chick-fil-A. I mean, is there a representative from Chick-fil-A?
Hi.
Hi.
My name is Jason Hill. I'm a development manager with Chick-fil-A.
Okay.
Good
great.
To see you.
Thank you. Jeremy had six questions, so I'm just going to go down. First one was, how is this drive-through going to be different than the Starbucks drive-through? I don't know if you're familiar with the Starbucks that we have in Solon.
I've seen it on aerial. I'd say probably the biggest difference between this drive-through and the Starbucks drive-through is we've thought through the volume of traffic that we're going to get on a consistent basis. And there's a natural traffic pattern that you take on our site to get into the drive-through and get out. I think the difference between that and Starbucks is it's a little counterintuitive the way that you approach their drive-through, and their stacking is extremely short until you start to impact the surrounding roads. Ours, as Mr. Hobbs mentioned, is 27 cars deep before it even gets to the access road to get into the site, probably closer to 30 cars before you get to the service road, and before you get to Cruise, you're probably closer to 35 or 38 cars. So. And that is well beyond most stacking we have through our sites across the nation. I'd say less than 1% have that amount of stacking available to them.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
And a couple other things I'll point out about the operation of the drive-through is that this building incorporates the latest and greatest in our thought and innovation around service in the drive-through. And so there are a few different aspects to that that really differ from not only other drive-thrus like Starbucks, but our own drive-thrus that currently exist in and around the Cleveland and Akron area. Mr. Hobbs mentioned we typically 10, 15 years ago would circulate the drive-thru around the building and the parking would be on the perimeter of the site. And with that, it would normally only include a single order point and one point to pick up. Now, our operators have gotten innovative over the years because the buildings themselves weren't necessarily designed to do the kind of volume that they're currently doing. Neither were the sites. Mm-hmm. On the flip side of that, these are. And so we've got individuals outside taking orders with iPads in two lanes versus the one lane on most of the other ones that you see around here. The second thing is we've got canopies to cover, so this can happen during all stages of weather, whether it be raining, whether it be cold, whether it be warm. The team members will always be protected underneath these canopies so we can run that play and keep the drive-thru running efficiently most of the time. And the third aspect, which again Mr. Hobbs mentioned, was the incorporation of a bypass lane as we execute the outside meal delivery play. And that's a huge benefit to get cars quickly through the drive-through. If you've got, you know, one, like my own wife would drive up in a minivan and order for all five of us and probably hold up the line, but she can then pull up and allow other folks who may have smaller orders to pull around her and keep the drive-through moving. Okay. Hope that helps.
Right. Next, I think that answered the second one, is how does the amount of car stacking compare to drive-through restaurants in the area? I mean, same thing. And then third question he asked is, how does the stacking count plus the parking lot availability compare to other locations? And then there's a couple other add-ons after that. So how does that stacking count compare?
So I can't speak, unless I had specific locations to talk about, but I can tell you most locations, especially around Cleveland, only have stacking available for maybe 13 to 15 cars until it starts to get.
Okay, so this is double.
This is double that, correct.
Okay. And then do you think there'll be enough parking if people are eating inside the restaurant?
Yes, I do.
And are we seeing an increased trends of online ordering and picking up in the restaurant?
Yes, that is a major major big move of ours internally in the company is to drive more sales mobily. It's picking up pace.
Okay. And then another question he has is, does Chick-fil-A have certain requirements for how many cars they would like to see stacked in their drive-thrus?
I don't know that we necessarily have a target. I think our goal is more to move them through as quickly as we can.
Okay.
We don't necessarily want cars stacking up, mm-hmm. you know, beyond our queuing lane.
Another question he had is, how is this going to be different than the restaurants in Harvard, Mentor, and other Chick-fil-A, local Chick-fil-A restaurants?
Well, I'll point back to the few points that I mentioned earlier around the drive-thru, but I will also say that inside the building, I think most of those stores that you mentioned are 4,000 to maybe 4,500 square feet. This building is 5,000 square feet, and within that, it comes with a larger kitchen that has a greater production capacity in it. And the second thing it has is a larger drive-through cockpit, which also allows you to prepare, assemble, and get the food out the window quickly, more quickly.
Okay. Does the fact that there's no pedestrian traffic near the drive-through window help the service of these restaurants?
It absolutely does. It does in that, in a typical scenario where it wraps around the whole building, you could have pedestrians wanting to cross through, and it would hold up the line and create a little bit of a gap. With this layout, you don't necessarily have that. So mm-hmm. you can complete the entire drive-through order without having any pedestrians crossing through it.
Okay. And is there going to be a different approach to the grand opening and early parts of the opening to ease traffic?
There absolutely will be. So what happens is, once we finish construction and turn it over, our grand opening team takes over. Along with the owner-operator. And what they do is, based on the site conditions, they devise a traffic management plan to handle those few days or week that sales volumes will be higher than normal. Mm-hmm. And what we like to do is, rather than prescribe a solution for them, we like to give them flexibility to do a couple things. You know, one, react to how the traffic actually starts to behave as the store opens, and two, work with, in this case, we have, you know, an adjacent property owner who we have to keep in mind as well, work with them to work on a solution that works for both parties. These particular folks have approval rights over our site plan. So, you know, as we talk about cross-access with them and, you know, potentially obstructing their drive there, like, we've passed all this through them, and they've approved this site plan layout. So they're aware, I think, of the risk of a popular business like Chick-fil-A coming in next to them. And thus far, we don't have pushback from them on this particular layout.
I guess one of the questions I have is, does Chick-fil-A have a prototype or standard size restaurant?
We do.
And what size is that?
So currently, we have several different size prototypes. Mm-hmm. You know, obviously, as we continue to develop, sites get more and more challenging to fit on. But in this particular case, we have the largest prototype that we have to offer, which is 5,000 square feet. Mm-hmm. And then it drops incrementally down from there. Right. But my goal is to get the largest restaurant with the most operational capacity on the sites if I can, which this right. one happens to accommodate it.
Right. No, because that seems to help operationally to keep things moving. Having that, because I know when McDonald's was looking to get on the corner of 91 and Aurora Road, what they wanted to put there was smaller than their prototype, and there just wasn't the room for the queuing and parking and what have you. So, okay. Those are the questions that we have. Did you have anything else?
No, not at this point.
Okay. All right. Seeing that Jeremy's not here, what I'd like to do is have a special meeting Tuesday before planning, and therefore we'd have three members available to vote on this issue. And then, therefore, it could be voted on, and if it's affirmative, it can go right into your planning meeting.
Okay.
Okay.
Do we have a time?
Oh, 6 o'clock.
6 o'clock? Okay,
right.
Great.
Okay.
Thank you.
Great, thank you. Anything else?
No, that's good. That's a good solution.
Okay. All right. Brings us to item number 10, status update report. Carrie?
Just a couple items on our status update. A couple of the commercial projects that were completed this past month were First National Bank on the corner there on Aurora Road near Somm Center, and then Rose's Italian Kitchen was completed. A couple of our city projects, the City Hall cul-de-sac project is out for bid currently. The Fire Station 1 roof replacement, they did some initial investigative work, was completed a couple weeks ago, so they're working on the getting the design package together. And then we just did the closeout for the pool HVAC. If anybody has any questions,
any questions?
For any other projects?
No. Thanks, Carrie.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, that brings us to the end of our agenda. Is there a motion to adjourn?
I move that we adjourn.
I will second that. Roll call, please.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Meeting adjourned. Thank you.